Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I, Charu, welcome you all to the day two of the 6th annual summit of Chief Learning Officers Summit India, the theme being Organizational Learning Impacting Business Changing the Game. We now begin with our morning session. I would like to invite on stage Mr. H.H. Radhanath Swami, author and a global spiritual leader. Born Richard Levin in his teens, he came to confront a deep sense of alienation from suburban Chicago life and the civil injustices of mid-century America. At the age of 19, while on a summer trip to Europe, his internal struggles culminated in a commitment to search for God wherever it might lead him. He traveled across India, meeting yogis, sadhus, Dalai Lama, Mother Teresa. India is the place where he found answers to his questions. He has been speaking in leading international conferences. His projects include Anamrita, which is midday meal project feeding over 1 million children every day across India, Bhakti Vedanta Hospital, Share Your Care, Govardhan Eco Village. Swamiji's projects have won several notable awards, like Greha Rating 5 from TERI, National Award from Honorable Finance Minister P. Chidambaram for Water Conservation, Times Quality Brand Award for Healthcare, Life Boy Award, and the D.Y. Patil Award for Midday Meal. Mr. H.H. Radhanath Swami is also the author of a very successful book, The Journey Home, Autobiography of an American Swami. Please welcome Mr. H.H. Radhanath Swami.
Timidandasya Gyananjana Chalakaya Chakshurun Milidham Jena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pristaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatyate Shatharine Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasati Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
It is my great honor fortune and pleasure to be with all of you today at this very relevant and needed conference, CLO. Thank you, Mr. Kumar, for inviting me to participate. I was asked to speak on how we could learn lessons that can not only equip us to live and serve within this world in a very significant way, but also lessons that can transform our lives, even from the most ordinary experiences in life. Not long ago, I decided to get away from all the demands and expectations in my life, because spiritual people also have that kind of situation. And I went to a forest. It's in Northern California. It's called Muir Woods. Gigantic redwood trees, sequoia trees are growing there. I just wanted to be left alone. As I was walking, I came upon a circle of about 25 Chinese tourists. In the middle of the circle was a forest ranger. So wanting to get away from people, I started walking a little faster. But then I heard the forest ranger say, "I am about to tell you the underground secret of the redwood forest." Now, I grew up in the 1960s as a teenager in America, so I'm naturally inclined toward underground secrets. So I stopped to listen. He explained how the redwood tree is the tallest, largest tree on planet Earth. And some of these trees are over 2,000 years old. He said, usually for a tree to survive and grow, the roots have to go very deep. But redwood trees, their roots don't grow deep. But yet these trees, over the thousands of years that they have been standing there, have endured massive forest fires, devastating earthquakes, frigid winters, storms, winds, tornadoes. How do they keep standing? And he paused to let us think about it. Then he explained, underground, the roots cannot be seen. But the nature of a redwood tree, the roots reach out to the roots of other redwood trees. And when two roots of two different trees come together, they wrap around each other and make a permanent knot. And all the roots of all the trees are reaching out to connect with each other. Unity's their strength. These gigantic redwood trees that are 2,000 years old, that are so tall, we came to one redwood tree, and there was a sign near it. It said, if a little mouse looks up at a 6-foot man, not a Bombay rat, a little mouse, it's the same experience as if a 6-foot man looks up at this tree. Huge. These giant trees, their roots go not only to other huge trees, but even to the little baby trees that are just coming out of the seed. Their fine little roots are wrapping around the big roots. And in this way, they're empowering each other to grow. And because of their unity, through the fires and through the windstorms, they keep growing and growing and growing. I found this to be such an incredible message. We see trees everywhere we go. But this invaluable lesson is right in front of our eyes, and how much we could learn. A few years ago, I saw in a newspaper the story of a basketball game. Now, what does a Swami have to do with basketball games? Really nothing. But there was something that really affected me. There was a star player in a world championship playoff, the last game. There was 2 seconds left. He was given the ball. If he made the basket, they win the world championship.
If he missed it, they lose. It's the last shot of the game. They're 1 point behind. Either they win or lose. It was an easy shot. If he made this basket, he would have won one of the greatest awards of making one of the most coveted records in basketball history. Something no one has ever done. How many points he scored in championships. He passed it to another person. That person, it went in, made the basket. They won. When he was asked, why didn't you do it? It was easy. You would have won a world record. He said, when I'm playing, I can't think about me. I have to think about the team. Yes, it was 90% I would have made it, but it was 95% he would have made it. In spiritual organizations, what to speak of politics or corporate world, the lesson is, it's not about me, it's about us. That consciousness where we help each other to grow. The giant redwood trees in the forest are totally dependent on the little trees. And the little trees are dependent on the giants and on each other. As was said in the introduction, when I was a teenager, I hitchhiked from London to India. And I traveled in the Himalayas as a sadhu, searching for spiritual meaning. Because I was born and raised in the United States of America, and I saw people had so much. But what confused me is they had so little. Because real happiness is a condition of the heart. There's a saying that human evolved society, people love people and use things. But unfortunately, sometimes we become so distracted by limitless weapons of mass distraction that we love things and use people to get them and keep them. From an economic perspective, from a political perspective, from an organizational perspective, it is an unsustainable model. And from a human perspective, there can be no real fulfillment in such a life. So I was looking for something meaningful and fulfilling that I can really connect my life to. And then, whether I become a millionaire or a billionaire or a monk or a swami, I found something rich within myself and I could share that with the world. I traveled in Himalayas, I live with many masters and yogis, and I'd like to teach a little lesson that really transformed me and helped me to follow the path that I'm on now. It was in Vrindavan. I was sleeping under a tree on the bank of the Yamuna River. And then Swami or Srila Prabhupada, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, he came to Vrindavan with about 40 disciples from all over the world. And somebody was introducing him, talking about his accomplishments, how he left Vrindavan with 40 rupees. He took a cargo ship across two oceans and three continents to New York City from Calcutta. And when he arrived, no one would change in 1965 rupees for dollars. So he had nothing, and he didn't know anyone, but he had such a determination to share the wealth of what he had within himself. And from that small beginning, he started an international society with thousands of people in temples, and I was sitting in his room next to him. There was only 5 or 6 people, and one journalist asked him a question. He said, "Are you the guru for the world?" And he looked down with such a humble expression and tears in his eyes. He was just sitting on the floor. He looked on the floor. He said, "No, I am just everyone's servant. That's all." That was his answer. And I was thinking, that's the person I want to follow. Such determination. Such incredible accomplishments. And he's being proclaimed the guru of the world, and he's saying, "No, I'm just the servant of everyone. That's all." And for me, it was that type of humility that really wanted me to dedicate myself to assist him. The Bhagavad Gita, there's a beautiful verse, yad yad acharati sreshtas, which means what leaders do, common people will follow. There's a saying, you can tell how rich you are by counting how many things you have that money cannot buy. Money cannot buy love, or peace, or inner fulfillment. Our character, our integrity, the values that we hold sacred, that is what brings about a fulfilling life. And when we find that wealth within ourselves, it humbles us. We realize, I'm not a master or a proprietor, I'm a caretaker. I'm a trustee of things that belong to a higher principle than just me. In the Gita, Krishna tells, I'm the strength of the strong, the intelligence, the intelligence, I'm the ability in people. Whatever we have, it's so much based on gifts we're receiving from nature, from God, and from so many other people. To be grateful. To be grateful means to be humbled by those gifts, to treasure their value, to utilize them with tremendous determination, tremendous insight, tremendous focus, to share what's been given to us. Not thinking I'm the giver, I'm the messenger. I remember another time someone spoke to my guru and said, thank you so very, very much for what you have given us. And he said, actually, I'm not given. He said, I'm just like a postman. It's coming from the higher powers of God and the saints and the great people. I'm just delivering the message. A similar thing I heard from Mother Teresa when I lived with her in 1971 in Calcutta. I came to her ashram, or her convent, and she was washing pots, huge pots. And they asked me to sit and wait for her. And we spoke for some time. And then some people from Britain came, some journalists, and one asked, How do you do so much? She said, it's God's work. I'm just an instrument. The inner satisfaction we get from feeling that higher power and being an instrument is millions of times greater than thinking that I am doing it myself. And also, it's so much more of a incentive to give and to do everything we can. Because we're representing something or people that we believe in. Whether it's a government, whether it's a company, whether it's God or our religion, to take responsibility and understand that the integrity of what we represent is how I speak and how I act and especially how I treat others. All of these thoughts were coming through my mind for days and days and days after I learned the underground secret of the redwood forest. The biggest tree is reaching out to make the little tiny seedlings become big like him. And the little tiny seedling knows it has the potential to be a part of an incredible forest. Every tree is dependent on every other tree. Another time, I write about this in my book, The Journey Home. I was at Prayag, the confluence of the Yamuna, Ganges, and Saraswati rivers. This was 1971. It was summer, and it was in the noontime. Extremely hot. I was thinking I'm going to go to the place of the Kumbh Mela where tens and millions of people gather every year. But when I came, there was no human anywhere around because it was just so hot. And I was sitting there on the banks of the Ganges, Yamuna, and Saraswati, and I had all these little scriptures with me, and I was thinking I'm going to learn something in this holy, sacred place. And as I'm doing my meditation and reading some little scriptures, trying to get some knowledge, I learned something that was, to me, the essence of all my chanting and all my meditation and all my scriptures from something I was about to see. It was a hawk flying just above my head, wings expanded. It was a really big hawk, brown, white, and golden wings. He had a really sharp, curved beak and yellow, glistening eyes that were looking down with tremendous focus. And he was right above my head. It looked like he was looking at me. And there was no one around. He was circling lower and lower and lower, and I looked up, and just a few meters above my head were his claws. They looked really sharp, and they were moving like they were ready to attack. Suddenly, dove right into the river, went underwater. And then I saw a skirmish. There was all kinds of splashing and splashing and splashing. The hawk came out with a fish in his claws. And it was just a few meters away from me. I was looking, and I could see the eyes of that little fish. It was about a foot long. that fish was squirming and flapping helplessly, and its eyes looked totally bewildered, disoriented, and helpless.
As the hawk flew higher and higher and took the fish into the forest. And I was thinking, what am I supposed to learn from this? There must be a message. We see these kinds of things every day.
I was thinking that little fish probably was just going about its day like any other day,
swimming upstream, downstream, across stream, maybe with family, friends, trying to get some food, trying to protect itself.
Had no consciousness that the hawk of fate was about to rip it out of its complacency, rip it out of its life.
I was thinking, how much is that like us? Like little fish, we're swimming around with the people we know, and we're going about our routines in life, and we're going through the challenges of life, but we don't know that any moment something could really rip us out of that state. We read about it. We see it on televisions. We hear about it. We know people it's happened to. But still, we just swim around. Complacency. When we understand the realities of this world, then we really put our consciousness on what really matters. Sometimes we just become so distracted. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna tells Arjuna what really matters and says that doesn't mean you should give up your duties. You should perform your duty with your full vigor and concentration. But understanding what your higher purpose is, then success, failure, victory, or success, failure, victory, defeat, honor, dishonor, these things come and go like the seasons. But our roots are in the real values that we're representing. The ultimate value is the love that's within all of us. To be an instrument of that love, to be an instrument of that power, to be an instrument of who and what we represent. Because we don't know what's going to happen in this world. There are so many uncertainties. But then I was thinking, if that fish was swimming deeper, the hawk couldn't catch it. So similarly, in whatever we're doing in our life, if we're doing it on a superficial level, near the surface, then we're subjected to all the different hawks of fate and destiny that may grab us. Meaning all the different situations that could come to disturb us and trouble us. But if we find that inner satisfaction in a deeper place, in our values, in our character, in our integrity, in our love, if we find that, then whatever may happen in the world, it can't change the quality of our life. If a house is built on a strong foundation, it can endure any storm. If a house, however beautiful it is built on shifting sand, then with a storm it crumbles. It's so important that on every level of society, we learn to find and develop that inner foundation of our life, those inner roots of our life, and empower one another, inspire one another, encourage one another to be the best we can. And in doing so, we grow.
Thank you very much.